Excuse me, officer. Can you tell me where the Pink Cloud Motel is?
Yeah. Just hang it right out here. Go down a little bit of ways. Can't miss it.
Well, how would you and your girlfriend there like to race me over?
Where's Philo Biddle?
How the hell do I know? Get off my porch with that thing. Get off my property.
You're not very hospitable.
Hospitable, my ass. Get off my porch.
Very well. You insist.
Put down that gun now!
I bleeped that out. Hi, and welcome to Ward 13 Ghosts of the Movies. My guest tonight is, why don't you introduce yourself, guest?
My name is Edward X. Young, and I'm a veteran of about 100 independent horror and science fiction movies.
And what is your connection to Manchester, New Hampshire?
Oh, Manchester, New Hampshire. Well, I grew up there. I'm a graduate of Manchester West High School class of 1977. The 4 years I spent there in high school were the happiest years of my life.
Oh, isn't that wonderful? Are you moving back to run for state rep or something? And no, don't answer that one. Ed, I asked you on because when we were kids at West High School, we were both... I wasn't a fan of Clint Eastwood. I think people used to... you were 6'3". You must have got a few jokes about Clint Eastwood. And I think you go ahead. About being that tall. No, Kung Fu. Everybody thought you were David Carradine.
That was in junior high school when I was in Long Island, New York. The way my hair was cut and Kung Fu was big on TV then. And I looked a lot, and I was taking martial arts, and that was known around the school. I was taking judo lessons, even though Kung Fu is a Chinese form of martial arts. But they started calling me Grasshopper in my junior high school.
Okay, Ed, that's enough bio. Sondra Locke, we just found out that Sondra Locke, who made 6 films with Clint Eastwood, who is definitely the John Wayne of our time, which actually John Wayne extended into our time, too. She passed. You have any comments about Sondra Locke?
Well, it's very sad. You know, I know a lot of people in Hollywood who are in the A-list, who are working in the higher levels, and it seems that Clint Eastwood is just universally beloved by everybody. He must treat the people he works with very well, and he makes films that make money, and he is a patriotic American, but it always stuck in the back of my head. There was one person on this planet who really hates Clint Eastwood and thinks he's a terrible person, and that would be Sondra Locke.
Well, I think she had a reason. They were together 13 years. Then she found out Clint had... I lived in Carmel by the Sea, California, in a shack 5 blocks from the beach, Monte Verde, and around the corner was one of Clint's mistresses and 2 bastards, you know, 2 illegitimate children. And she wasn't the only one, Ed. He was like the father of the town as well as the former mayor. Oh, great picture. I think Sondra Locke was nominated for an Oscar in 68 when she played, I think it's like a 14 or 15-year-old girl in The Heart is a Lonely Hunter with Alan Arkin as a deaf mute.
Was her first movie, too, wasn't it? She gets an Oscar nomination for her very first screen role.
Oh, yeah. And she was excellent. Alan Arkin was great in it, too. He finally got his Oscar many years later. But strangely, because she was like a strange talent of that time. I guess Mia Farrow would probably...
Well, it's interesting. Most of Eastwood's other exes speak highly of him, but they weren't in show business. Sondra Locke, what is tragic is that, you know, she was extraordinarily beautiful, very waif-like, the blonde hair, the blue eyes. But not only was she beautiful, she was a great actress, and she had higher aspirations. She wanted to be a film actor, wanted to be a director.
She was a director.
It helped to go far, to be a power player in Hollywood. Maybe she probably hoped it. It was probably within her ambition to end up like what Julia Roberts might be today, or what Sandra Bullock might be today. I mean, she was hoping to go up to that level. And maybe she thought she was making a wise decision hanging it all on Clint Eastwood, but maybe he couldn't take a woman as powerful as she was.
Well, we're here to talk.
Reins that he insisted on putting
we're
on
talk,
her.
We're talking. Okay, Ed. Ed.
She was really dominated by him, and the rules were you only work for me.
Okay, Ed.
You know,
Ed. I'm going to hang up.
If she had her own identity instead of Clint Eastwood's. You know,
Ed.
Girlfriend, you know.
Ed, shut up.
Girlfriend who took him away from his wife.
Shut up.
His children in the eyes of the public, even though he had many mistresses.
Ed,
shut
up.
It certainly, she certainly wasn't.
This guy's crazy. Folks, this guy's crazy.
Yeah, I will say that.
I'm sure people that know him are watching. Why can't you shut up?
She faltered with some of her... failures.
Can you believe this, Paul? This guy, he just keeps going. Why do you keep going on?
Jumping ahead of the game with that one?
No, we're not interested. We're going to talk about movies. First of all, your opinions is you know.
Hello?
Jeez, you call in Matt.
I lost my connection.
You lost your connection, huh? Are you still there?
I lost my connection.
You can't hear me? That's a good thing in a way. Did you hang up on him, Paul?
I didn't lose my connection. Okay, did you lose me? Could you hear me?
Ed, I told you to shut up. You just kept going on and on. You know, we're here to talk about the movies that she was in, not I'm wondering, are you sure it was just a sandwich you had before the show?
I worked all day, too. I slaved like a slave at work all day, so my head's a little fuzzy, and it is.
Okay. There's going to be some give and take here. I'm the director. One thing about Sondra Locke, she was married to another guy all the entire time she was with Clint Eastwood, and I don't look into their lives. The point is that she will be remembered because she was the co-star of Clint Eastwood, and the first movie they co-starred in is a great movie, The Outlaw Josie Wales, which I remember Orson Welles said that. It was he commented, Clint, it must have been, he started directing in 71, that's 76, he made maybe 4 or 5 films, and Orson Welles said that was a great movie, and he was very, very impressed, and that's a classic now, The Outlaw Josie Wales.
Which also featured William McKinney.
Bill McKinney. Bill McKinney, known far and wide for his role in Deliverance, but we're not going to get into that. I actually have a clip of Bill McKinney, Sondra Locke, and Clint Eastwood in The Gauntlet. And, Paul, do you think we should? I have censored it and cut it. So, do you want to run that one?
Did it need to be censored?
Oh, yeah. You know, it's called The Education of a Cop. And but we might get to that a little later.
You want me to run it, you said?
Yeah, let's run it. I'm sure I've got it thoroughly censored because it's a great scene. I'll always remember the scene because it shows about them bonding, the two characters in All the right, gauntlet.
I can't hear it, but you I assume you'll talk when it's over.
How many times a month you
Just drive the car, will you?
See, now, I got me a chance to learn something, Colonel. I mean, as long as I got a chauffeur, the little strumpet, you don't mind if a country boy picks up a little education, do you? I got this here buddy. He had the idea one time we'd open up a string advertising like them fried chicken places. Finger licking good. How's it work with your kind? You go to some kind of special school or something?
I have a BA from Finch College.
Is that where you learned how to give
a You shut up for Christ's sake.
Hey now, Colonel, you come to the strumpet's rescue. I bet you had some ideas to get some gas yourself. Maybe you already had a taste of it, huh? Ain't nothing like a slice of the damn You can't fool old Deke. I seem to zip in your fly, you
Will bastard. You shut up?
It's all right, let him talk.
Hey, come on, talk to me. I want to know what it's like being a whore.
Actually, I always thought it was rather like being a cop.
You did?
Yeah. Not unlike being on the take at two dozen bars in downtown Vegas. Taking money from some politician each time you peel his drunken kid's Cadillac off a telephone pole. Strong-arming the Chicanos and the Barrio on Saturday night, busting kids for smoking grass, then taking a kickback from the heroin dealers. Or those occasions when you do bust a pusher and skim the hall when you've made the collar, so what you skim to your dope addict buddies on the porch.
She's sure on all our chicks, ain't she?
As I see it, the only difference between you and me is that when I quit work, I take a long, hot bath. I'm as clean as the day I was born. But a cop, especially a flunky like you, the sheriff whistles, you squat. And what he does to you rots your brain. No amount of water on earth can get you clean again.
You ought to sit there and take that kind of crap.
You were the one who wanted to talk.
I know you don't like women like me. We're a bit aggressive. We're frightened. But that's only because you've got filth in your brain, and I'm afraid the only way you'll ever clean it out is to put a bullet through it. Well, does your wife know you masturbate?
You've had your chat, now drive.
No, you don't. It's a public TV channel, you dumb. Well, we won't, I think we actually saw The Gauntlet in 1977 over at the Bedford, the mall, the cinema there. I'm sure you and I saw it. That's,
I thought that came out after I moved away after graduation. I remember that being one of the first movies I saw.
Oh.
That was one of the first movies. Well, let's see when the release date was.
Yeah, I can look that up. Christmas of 1977, so it was after we graduated. We must have seen other Clint Eastwood. We saw Chinatown and other movies together, but yeah, it was. I didn't realize Clint Eastwood had directed that. I thought it was another person directed it. And
believe it or not, it was released on the 21st of December in 1977. And I do recall it was one of the first movies I'd seen after I'd moved away from Manchester. I saw it in New Jersey, and I remember.
Okay, we have a lot of details. There's a poster here of the Gauntlet, Paul. If you can zoom in, or if you can find one, it's famous because it's by like a great poster artist. And
is it a movie poster?
Yeah,
I'll
the
just
Gauntlet.
Put it up behind you.
Yeah, but I'd say that was probably. You know, The Outlaw Josie Wales is a great movie, but it was a Western. Of course, he was the number one box office star three times, maybe four times in his career. But The Gauntlet was probably, of the films they made together, that's probably, I think, the best one with her in it and her character. Because she's a criminal. He picks up to take to a hearing. And the odds are stacked against him. And he is the anti-Dirty Harry. The interesting thing, we'll talk about Clint Eastwood, and then you can chime in about Eastwood, and you can have a diatribe if you'd like. Eastwood did play, morally compromised characters. Think about how radical Dirty Harry was when that came out when we were kids. We were like, I was 11 and you were 12 years old because you're a few months older than me. You know,
Didn't Pauline Kael call that a fascist movie?
We don't need that to talk about that. The point is he's playing characters unlike like a John Wayne. John Wayne once criticized. Oh, we finally lost them. Paul, you have. I'll give him a call again. Paul, what was your first Clint Eastwood movie that you remember seeing in a theater?
It was. Actually, Every Which Way But Loose.
I saw Every Which Way But Loose the day before my brother, or a few days. You know how memory is. He was going off into the Air Force, and we went to see it. And I love that movie, you know. It's one of my favorite all-time films. And it's funny. Years later, I was talking to my father, and that was at what's the Rex Theater, but it was called The Movies then. And years later, my father told me, before my Uncle Chester went off to World War II, they went and saw The Glass Key at the Rex Theater. And if you go online, you can actually find the ad to the Rex Theater in The Glass Key. And he went off to World War II. And it's funny, you know, how coincidences are. But I'll try getting Ed back. But
yeah, go ahead.
Why did you – well, I love – one of the things, Ruth Gordon – was so great in the movie. I think we got a clip. We have a clip of that. Well, we already ran one.
Which one?
Well, we ran the one with her. I don't think I have any bespoke clips of her. Online, there's some clips, but at the ending, we have it. And I love Jeffrey Lewis, who is the character actor. You know, Clint always had a great, what would you call it, repertory company with him. And Bill McKinney, but everybody would always think of Jeffrey Lewis, who I always thought that Jeffrey Lewis's Orville was his brother, because Clint calls her Ma, and maybe they are in a way, or it doesn't matter. But do you have any comments about Jeffrey Lewis, Paul?
That's your caller. Just pick him up.
Okay. Do I just hit?
Just hit the green button, and there's like a 10-second delay. Okay.
Okay. The button with I'm colorblind.
Just the on, it says on, off.
Okay.
Okay, hit it once.
I did.
Okay, and wait, he'll...
I'm back. Oh, here we go. I can hear you.
Okay, we're talking about Every Which Way But Loose, which you know that Ruth Gordon was a lot like my mother, which was one of the funniest things. And my mother would never... She'd never wear her glasses when she went to the DMV, which is the Ruth Gordon character. But we're talking about Jeffrey Lewis. He's one of my favorite character actors and one of the people that you would most associate with the repertory company around Clint Eastwood. I know Paul, he's one of his favorite actors. Do you have any comments about...
The best ever.
Oh yeah, he was great. What was he in? High Plains Drifter. He was great. You have any comments about Jeffrey Lewis?
I have met Jeffrey Lewis's daughter and seen him as a rock and roller.
Anything you can think of, Paul, that you'd like to put up there would be great. But, you mean Juliette Lewis, who went on to be nominated for an Oscar.
I saw her with her band. She's a damn good punk rocker. If you see her band playing, The Licks, Juliette Lewis and The Licks, as an old-time CBGB musician, at first I thought I was going to be watching some Hollywood pretender, and my friends and I, who were all musicians, said, this chick could rock. I mean, she's like Joan Jett almost. She's
We're talking about Clint Eastwood. You're more scattered than I am.
Well, I wanted to say too. Yes, your mom looked a lot like Ruth Gordon,
and sounded like her.
A lot like her. And your pet chimpanzee was a lot like that orangutan.
Well, that was my kid brother. The one that, they had the unfortunate accident. You know what a great Clint Eastwood movie was? And I saw it with my father and my brother Guy. Oh, let's go with that, Paul. This is one of the, I love this. This is when the ape steals the Oreos.
When I was convinced that my opinion was that The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly was the greatest movie ever made.
It is a great movie.
And then I saw Chinatown in high school, and I changed my opinion.
Oh, yeah, we saw it together 3 times in a row, remember? I had seen it with my father. Probably it's good that we don't have their comment about the baboon. I mean, she calls him a hairy baboon, but he's an orangutan. But one of the great movies, I saw it with my father, and it was directed by Michael Cimino in 1974, and Jeff Bridges got an Oscar nomination, and Jeffrey Lewis was in it. Can you name that movie, Ed Young?
Yes, I can. Thunderbolt and Lightfoot.
Oh, yeah. I got a DVD on it. I'll have to let you borrow it, Paul.
I'm a big Jeff Bridges fan because I'm often mistaken for being him. It's happened to me on at least 4 occasions. People have asked for my autograph thinking that I'm Jeff Bridges.
Yeah, people think I'm Paul Williams.
When my hair is white and I got the beard and the lights are dim and I'm hanging around Lincoln Center, people say, are you Jeff Bridges?
Ed, you're very eccentric, and, you can call it, we can have a show about your career, but we're talking about Thunderbolt and Lightfoot and Clint Eastwood. That was directed by Michael Cimino. I think it's the first film he ever directed.
Until he destroyed himself by going apeshit.
You can't say that, you idiot. Did you get that, Paul? I'll just talk to Paul if you can't focus, Ed.
Oh, no, no. Well, but Cimino burned himself out by going nuts.
And we are talking about Clint Eastwood.
Okay, Clint Eastwood. But poor Sondra Locke.
No, we're talking about Clint Eastwood right now in his films. We're talking about Jeffrey Lewis. Jeez, this is like pulling teeth. You're my most difficult interview I've ever had.
You know why? I was a big fan of Eastwood and still am.
Well, we're talking about the character actors around them. Like he had Bill McKinney. Bill McKinney played the head of the Red Legs in The Outlaw Jesse Wales.
Well, I want to go back to something you mentioned earlier. The poster for The Gauntlet, of course, was done by the great Frank Frazetta, considered the greatest cover artist of comic books and graphic novels. I mean, the Frank Frazetta is like it. He's number one.
Sondra Locke is the person that was her idea.
Oh, really? To get Frazetta? I didn't know that. Yeah. Wise decision. I used to own a copy of the poster, and somebody stole it from me.
Yup. You have any comments about the... Because he used to have, like, a repertory company of actors around him, like Altman used to have, but after Pink Cadillac, he didn't use them anymore.
Time marches on.
You have
but
no
what's interesting is that...
How about you, Paul? You have a comment.
The gauntlet, by the way, the gauntlet, the musical scoring artist was Jerry Fielding, who was Sam Peckinpah's regular scoring artist, who scored The Wild Bunch, of course, and also Straw Dogs.
Yeah, and he also, I think, yeah. Suddenly you're not so loquacious.
Well, I mean, no, it had a great musical score. I mean, the Gauntlet is probably their best movie as a couple because it's a great movie. It's a terrific action film, and if you love guns, well, hell, it's...
it has a monumental shootout with a... Clint has to come in a bus. It's well worth watching. Now, Pat Hingle was in there, but Pat Hingle was in his first major American film, Hang Them High, which was directed by Ted Post. I always found Pat Hingle irritating. He was always on the streets of San Francisco. He'd always be in one of the early episodes. And each season he played a different character. And Don Stroud would be on the streets of San Francisco. Not, you know, on the same. And Don Stroud was in Coogan's Bluff.
That's right.
Yeah.
A terrific movie shot on location in New York City. Since I ended up leaving Manchester and becoming a New Yorker for about a decade, for most of the 80s into the early 90s, I have affection for Coogan's Bluff.
Oh, certainly you do. And probably for Hillbillies and a Haunted Mansion, too, but we won't get into that. How's your friend Linda Blair?
Don Stroud, what did I most recently see him in? He was in Django Unchained, Don Stroud.
Yeah, he lost his career because he was in a bad fight and lost an eye. But he was an interesting character actor.
I didn't know that he lost an eye in a fight. I didn't know that.
That's why he stopped for a long time. You know, he went on. Well, when you get to 65, you can get your SAG pension. That's why you'll notice, like Ned Beatty. You know, he retires at 65. A lot of actors take their pension.
Yeah, I'm surprised that a guy like Ned Beatty hangs it up. But look at Eastwood. Eastwood said he was going to hang it up as an actor. Made it very clear. After I do this movie, Gran Torino, I'm not acting anymore. I may still produce or direct, but this is my swan song as an actor. But here he is. I haven't seen it yet, but The Mule opened on Friday. I plan to see it Christmas Day.
Huh? I didn't even know. That he did direct another movie.
The Mule. He plays a drug runner. He plays like a loving grandpa who's been making money by running dope across the border,
really?
For years. Yeah, the thing that Eastwood is 88 years old, and he's producing, directing, co-writing, and starring in another movie. I think he's gone beyond John Wayne. I mean, he's really become a remarkable, absolute iconic landmark. Maybe nobody can equal Clint Eastwood in Hollywood. I mean, 88 years old, producing, directing, co-writing, and starring in another picture, which will probably be a hit.
Well, the thing is that Clint went on after Pink Cadillac. It was almost like a 20-year-long apprenticeship. And then he developed into a great director. Unforgiven was a great movie. He won a Best Director Oscar. And The Million Dollar Baby was very good. I'll tell you what, his performance in Million Dollar Baby, he was excellent. It's one of the best performances I've seen by, a senior actor. You know, it's difficult to get old and perform when you're older, particularly when you were a great star.
Oh, of course. A lot of them just become forgotten memories on the nostalgia circuit. That's Hey, look, I go to a lot of conventions. You know, I see them at conventions all the time.
Yeah, but you don't see people of the of Clint Eastwood's stature. He was a number one box office star, 22 years on the top 10 list. Paul Newman would be an equivalent. Paul Newman, who was originally offered Dirty Harry and turned it down because of... You know, that's somebody that's equivalent. But, of course, Paul was a greater actor in terms of talent, and he certainly had some great roles towards the end of his career. But a lot of thought.
One could argue that. The greater actor, they had a different style. They're both great. I mean, I'm a big Paul Newman fan, too. But, I mean, Eastwood's a great actor.
He was a great movie star. It's a different thing. But he finally, as he got older, acted. Nobody would say he was an actor. Remember what Sergio Leone said about him? Compared to, of course, they were feuding because he wouldn't make Once Upon a Time in America. But the difference between, Robert De Niro was a great actor until, recently. When he went for the paychecks.
He's become a parody of himself. I can hardly stand watching a De Niro movie.
Yeah, but at his height, except for his inexpressive voice, he was a great, great actor. The subtlety of his face and the expressions. Eastwood was a great movie star. But John Wayne was a great movie star, and he had a few great roles. His Rooster Cogburn, who could ever forget that, And he was such a generous actor, his co-stars.
Do you know the anecdote where Eastwood got his voice, the voice that he used throughout his career?
No.
Well, I know this story. In the beginning of his career, he was told by his agent and by casting directors that he was a lousy actor, that he should give up acting and take up something like carpentry, that he'd never make it. His first two movies, of course, he had bit parts in. His first movie, Revenge of the Creature, 1955, where he played an affable, goofy, geeky scientist with a pet rat. And then he was in Tarantula as the jet fighter pilot that kills the big spider.
But he was told in Francis the Talking Mule.
He was told that he was a terrible actor. Even his own agent dropped him. And then he was sitting in a movie theater watching an actress who totally captivated him. And he was watching the movie, I think it was Viagra with Marilyn Monroe.
Viagra? She certainly was Viagra. I've read extensively about Clint Eastwood. I just reread Schickel's biography recently, which he doesn't talk about that story.
I've heard this, that he noticed how she whispered, and you had to pay attention to hear what she was saying.
The actor that influenced his screen personality was Gary Cooper. Everybody knows that. He did a special about that about 25 years ago about Coop. The way he talked, the minimalism of Coop.
I read a story that he was inspired watching Marilyn Monroe and how the audience shut up and listened when she spoke because she whispered, and he realized, I'm going to speak in a semi-whisper.
Him saying that, never mentioning this and saying that it was Gary Cooper that he modeled himself after. Come on, Ed. Gary Cooper Orson Welles.
I'm in show business now. Films and music. People invent their own legends.
We're talking about Clint Eastwood, one of the great superstars of all time. He was the number one box office star in the world before he became one with Dirty Harry in the United States. I think that 40 years of Clint Eastwood telling the same story and looking him on the screen, because Orson Welles, when he went to Hollywood in 1940, they took him on a set with Gary Cooper, and they said, cut, print. And he says to the director, I can't remember who it was, he didn't do anything. He says, wait till you see it, the rushes. And then that's it. The camera either loves you or it doesn't. You either have it or you don't. You can't really learn. You can learn to act for film. I remember, we've talked about it. You get raising, the camera, knowing what the lens is, having your chin up at a certain lighting, stuff like that. Brando knew all that type of stuff. But you either have it or you can't. It's like, Laurence Olivier was a great actor, a great stage actor. Had great roles in film, too. But you don't think of him as the great film actor because he never
Now this is gonna blow your mind.
Now we're gonna find out Laurence Olivier, and Clint were lovers, right?
I'm gonna blow your mind right now while we're talking. This is interesting what I just discovered because I'm online while I'm talking to you.
Oh, but I don't want that crap.
No, this is gonna amaze you because the story about Eastwood being inspired by Marilyn Monroe came from Sondra Locke in her biography, The Good, the Bad, and the Very Ugly, where she claims that Clint told her that he stole the idea.
Have you read the book?
I'm reading a section of it right now online.
Okay, Ed, let's you know, that's stupid. It's silly. That's kind of interesting. They said to Charles Bronson he'd never be an actor. They said that to Lee Marvin and all sorts of actors, the guys that clawed their ways up. You know, Harrison Ford was a carpenter, but he fell in with the Coppola organization.
You mean Charlie Buchinski, the Lithuanian Pennsylvania coal miner who became a superstar?
Well, not quite Clint Eastwood class, although by 74 he was an international superstar.
Well, don't forget, poor Charlie Bronson got felled by getting Alzheimer's, and that's what forced him to drop out of pictures.
Who cares?
So he ultimately died from it. It was affecting him near the end of his career, too.
His career was over by then, but he made his big mark. He became a big star in France.
Oh.
And then the films like Red Sun, where he's with Alain Delon, and he's a huge star in Japan. Didn't your mother go to Japan? Or somebody I know. And they used to have a huge poster of him.
My father did business in Japan, and he came back. He showed me a photo that he took of a ten-story tall painting of Clint Eastwood on the side of a building in Japan.
Oh, I thought it was Charlie Bronson.
It was both of them. They were both stars, Bronson and Eastwood. They worshipped them both there.
You know, it's unusual that those two were never in a film because I never saw it in the theater, but they finally paired up Paul Newman and Steve McQueen. Steve McQueen was obsessed with Paul Newman's career, you know.
And
of course, he became a great superstar.
They did pair up Eastwood and Burt Reynolds.
Oh, God, that was a god-awful movie.
Yeah, and that's where I think that's where Reynolds got injured very badly and never fully recovered, and it led to him getting hooked on painkillers and the decline of his career.
Yeah, he in one of the scenes, the stuntman missed and hit him with a chair, and he got that awful thing in your jaw?
Yeah, well, his jaw got knocked loose, and I think he lost his front teeth too.
But it's a condition.
And he suffered in chronic pain for the rest of his life, which got him turned him into an opiate addict.
Well, it affected his timing.
Yeah.
We were talking about Burt Reynolds a couple months ago. The guy, five times in a row, box office star. First of all, when he did that, pulled that from like 77 to 81, he was the first person to do it since Bing Crosby, who also did it five times in a row. And they're the only top people until the rise of the generation Tom Cruise and Hanks that did do five times. But then his career just completely fell off the face of the earth. And he always felt, because unlike Clint Eastwood, who didn't go on talk shows, who didn't, you know, constantly give all these details of his life, who didn't clown around, you know, all the exposure he had did his movie career in. And, of course, all those god-awful movies he made.
Yeah.
Because he was a talented actor.
It's tough being number one, because when you lose that, you kind of lose your mind, maybe. I mean, when you're the number one, I bet it's a lot more comfortable being like the very best character actor in Hollywood, being a guy like Joe Spinell or Strother Martin.
Sure it is. Who would want to be Paul Newman or Clint Eastwood, you know, being offered millions of dollars, the chance to direct, Academy Awards, stuff like that? Who'd want that? What a tough life, huh? I saw him in 1985 when I was at DLI. The only time I saw him, and he was a nice guy. He actually looked like a movie star. Most movie stars don't look anything, you know, like themselves.
I interviewed Paul Newman.
Because he's 6'4". I've met Paul Newman too, because he used to come up here to New Hampshire, but you saw him in Peterborough. He's somebody go ahead.
He was acting in Our Town on Broadway, and he wanted to go to check out the actual Our Town, which is Peterborough, where Thornton Wilder lived when he wrote the play. And I found him in the railroad car diner, the Peterborough diner, where you and I have had lunch. I think I treated you to a lunch there.
We're not writing a novel now. That's my specialty.
You owe me a lunch now.
And Paul Newman didn't like being famous, and he didn't like dealing with people, you know. He just wanted to be treated like a regular person. But you can't be.
Boy, that was
You can't.
I would love to eat this.
And his wife, you know, an Oscar winner, told him to, he was grumpy with you, and that's my hat, grumpy. And she got him to sign an autograph or something, right?
His lovely wife convinced him to give me a brief interview. She said he seems like a very nice gentleman, Paul. Give him 5 minutes of your time. And so I did a 5-minute interview while he was in town. It got published in the local paper.
The Keen Sentinel, right?
Yes. No, in the Monadnock Ledger, the local paper. Okay. Joanne Woodward was instrumental in me securing the interview. He wanted to brush me off.
They lived in Westport, Connecticut, not far from the VA hospital there. Our congregational minister came from Westport to Manchester, and they have the thing where they want you to give money. I'm thinking, you're not in Westport anymore, buddy. That was our rich B-I-T-C-H country.
I witnessed an interesting bickering argument between Joanne Woodward and Paul Newman.
Well, we're not interested in that type of gossip here. Ward 13 with John Hopwood going to the movies.
Not interested, Ed.
Ed, the point is, you take Burt Reynolds, Richard Schickel, who's now passed, was a great film critic. He wrote a cover story about Burt Reynolds and about Burt Reynolds becoming a director. It was about 77 or 78, and he wanted them to throw Clint Eastwood in because, you know, people didn't want to, like Pauline Kael and critics, didn't want to deal with Clint Eastwood, you know. They didn't want to take him seriously, and then they contrasted the two careers. And Burt's movie directing career just didn't go that far, you know? Although I think he directed the TV show, some episodes on that, but...
Two interesting
careers.
I think Eastwood's a smarter guy with a better head on his shoulders. And Burt Reynolds was always a bit of a wild man, and, you know, and he did... Even before he got injured, I mean, he got high a little bit too much. You know, the booze and the drugs and the different broad every night. A little bit of a wild man.
I never heard that.
Yeah. Eastwood's always been a bit more, responsible. And I've met people that have worked on his films. They've told me his films are like an absolute joy to work on. I mean, they run like a smoothly oiled machine.
The same crew, same editor, same cinematographer.
And they all love him. It's a great experience. It's a great experience, they say, working on an Eastwood picture.
Oh, Clint doesn't waste any money at all. He does very few, pickups. You get the shots. He's very tight with a budget. So the movie companies, like he was with Warners forever, if he's not still with Warners. He never wasted any of their money. You know,
similarly, the people I've met from Hollywood, you know, set designers and cameramen and sound guys, they said the same thing about working with John Wayne. It was also, he was the best guy in Hollywood to work for. It was you get a job on a John Wayne picture, and it was going to be a great time.
Well, that was a repertory company, too, you know. They were all those character actors.
Yeah, I mean, you were very accurate. I mean, he is sort of the new John Wayne, but he's different. Maybe he's gone beyond John Wayne, you know? I think he may have gone beyond Wayne.
Well, John Wayne's problem, and Eastwood talked about it, because I think when Josie Wales was getting great publicity, or it could have been another film earlier on. He said to him that you shouldn't make a Western like that because we're not covering it because we got a waylaid. But Clint Eastwood was very much... an actor of the anarchic, the end of the 60s and the 70s, even though people consider him a reactionary before in the 80s when he's finally embraced for who he truly was. But that was a very hard-edged character of him. You know, the duality, the amorality of it all. He was not a classic American Western hero. You know, he played both. The whole thing, like when we were kids, he played both ends against the middle.
Yeah, but let's also face it. The Duke wasn't that good a director. Most of the movies he directed didn't do that well. He was better The Duke was a movie. John Wayne was a movie star.
He directed one movie that I know of. He directed The Alamo. And he had to have John Ford come in to do some pickups for him.
Yeah, yeah. But Eastwood arguably is a better director than he is an actor, and he's a pretty damn good, I think he's a phenomenal film director. He's a great auteur. There's a definite Eastwood style, you know.
But
Eastwood's up there with John Ford, you could even say.
Who influenced them, of course. And so did George Stevens. George Stevens was a great director that... thanks, audience. George Stevens won 2 Oscars. He directed Shane, famously, but he didn't win the Oscar for that. He won it for A Place in the Sun and Giant, which is a gigantic bore, if you ask me. But a great film director. Shane very much influenced him as a director. You can see it in the compositions and just Stevens type of stuff, which was removed. There's there's a removed quality of it. But Clint Eastwood had 3 careers, if you get to it. You know, he reinvented himself. He reinvented himself. When he shot Bird and he made his last Clint Eastwood movie, which would be Pink Cadillac, which wasn't a great hit. And then he created a new era, you know. And then he consciously did that. You know, he took all that criticism by Pauline Kael, who just despised him, seriously. And but that's what a great artist does, you know. You have to be conscious of... yourself and your critics. You have to be able to change. And he did.
Well, it's like, if somebody doesn't hate you, then you're not doing something right. And, you know, Pauline Kael also hated Sam Peckinpah totally, completely, absolutely.
That's not true. Yeah. That's completely false. She was a great supporter of Sam Peckinpah. I think you're, what are you on tonight?
What?
What are you on tonight?
Coca-Cola.
You've been sniffing the kimchi again?
I'm sipping a bottle of Coca-Cola while I'm talking to you.
Yeah, that's the Ed we all know. Huh? What's in the bottle of Coca-Cola?
That's true. Coca-Cola and you know, Pop Rocks, it's a killer combination, you know. But Pink Cadillac, yeah, I'll still watch anything that Bernadette Peters is in. She's the most watchable. In her prime, she was the most watchable actress around in my book.
Well, she never had much of a career.
No, she had a phenomenal Broadway career. Are you kidding me? She's like the queen of Broadway.
We're talking about movies.
Well, I know. You said she never had much of a career. She's got a career. I just saw her in Hello, Dolly. It was the number one show to get tickets for last summer.
Well, Tammy Grimes was a great Broadway star in the 50s and 60s, and her Tammy Grimes show lasted 1 episode back in 1966. That used to be a trivia question, but I'm sure there's lots of shows that just last 1 episode. Now. We're talking about Eastwood. Eastwood is an iconic figure. We can do a show on Sam Peckinpah, dude, but you've got to get your facts straight, because Pauline Kael is a big supporter of him. I was just watching part of... Billy, Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. You had Strother Martin wasn't in that, but L.Q. Jones, the part where, go ahead.
I think she hated The Wild Bunch.
She didn't hate Pat Garrett. You don't know about Pauline Kael. I actually dated her, you always like the name drop, so do I. I dated her grandniece when I was in the Army. That was a real kick in the head. You don't know about Pauline Kael. So let's not get into it.
I wonder why Eastwood never worked with Peckinpah. Is there a story behind that? I mean, we're talking
who would work with Sam Peckinpah? Undisciplined, and he'd go through a budget. Why do you think he became his own director? He wouldn't put up with any crap. And he virtually was with directors. You know, Ted Post had directed him on Rawhide because, you know, he was... TV star, not of the first rank, but in Rawhide. Ted Post was one of the directors. He directed Hang 'Em High, which he got, I think, $750,000. That's his first American movie as a star, and it was a hit, and it established him. But he virtually, you know, ran that set, and it would irritate Ted Post. And so he eventually, him and Don Siegel, they were a great combination. See, Don Siegel directed Dirty Harry, and he was considered a liberal filmmaker. Dirty Harry, we could do a whole, just the first movie, which is a classic film. You know, it was denounced as reactionary. But, you know, we don't have time to really go into Clint. You could, you know, we could talk hours about Clint Eastwood. But I don't know. Sondra Locke was a unique talent. Mia Farrow arrives at the same time, and she was similar, you know, the gamin and the ethereal.
Well, I think it's a tragic figure. I think that she had enormous potential. I mean, yeah, okay. I read that when she died, she was worth $20 million, so she wasn't starving.
Well, that was Clint Eastwood's money.
her estate was $20 million bucks, but I mean, who knows? I don't think she fulfilled her potential as an artist, and Hollywood did kind of use her, chew her up, and spit her out.
Ever happen to anybody else? She sued Clint for a palimony and got a good settlement because he was really pig-headed at the trial. But, you know.
But also terrible to get hit with the cancer at such a young age, too, which really felled her. You know, double mastectomy and the cancer continuing to return over the years, you know, thinking she was in remission and it would come back, you know. I mean, she struggled for a good 20 years. I mean, she died at 74, but the last 20, 25 years of her life must have been hell.
Yeah, but the point is, Eddie, after she gets nominated for an Oscar in 1969, she didn't do anything substantial work until The Outlaw Josie Wales, which is a character part.
Isn't the Oscar sometimes like a curse, you know? I mean, she gets nominated for an Oscar for her very first screen role. And then, you know, I mean, look what happens to other people who hit it really big. Orson Welles. I mean, you know, you hit it big.
Orson Welles was profitable.
Early on, or get nominated even early on, and then it just, then everything is compared. Like, well, your new picture wasn't as good as the last one. You know, Sondra, your performance is pretty good in Willard.
It's irrelevant.
Well,
Marlon Brando was a big hit on Broadway at 23 and a movie star at 27, you know? He got an Oscar. Youngest guy to get an Oscar, you know?
I can see them questioning Sondra Locke's wisdom acting in a horror movie like Willard, which I love. But I mean,
that's,
you know,
right,
after,
she was in Willard. Okay. No obscenities, audience. Eddie's an eccentric, and he does have roots in Manchester. He lied to me and got me to the first high school reunion I was ever at. How did we all get so old?
They want you to come back to the one in the summer, by the way. I'll let you know about it straight up, and I hope you'll join us at the picnic in the summer.
Ooh, I'll pass on that. Oh, the halcyon days. Well, the conversation didn't turn out like I thought it would, and we got 2 minutes. You really were on Hinge there at the beginning, Ed. We're going to have to make that into some type of, like, disc tape.
I was always very attracted to Sondra Locke. I thought she was a beautiful woman. She should have gone further. And, you know, I'm a horror film guy, and she did a number of horror and science fiction things. Willard, Reflecting the Fear. She was in Night Gallery. Yeah, she was in Planet of the Apes, the TV series. So, I mean, I guess...
I don't even remember there was a TV series. You know, and all that, the narrative, oh, poor this, poor that, you got screwed in Hollywood. It's a tough, tough business. And, you know, even people that get up top a crater after several years, you know. The people like a Clint Eastwood is unique, but he did it his way, and he did it with every ounce of will. He wrung every bit of talent out of himself and surpassed it. He learned from people. It's like a great American story in a way. But okay, I got to wrap up now. Thanks for coming. We can do, if we do a thing about Sam Peckinpah, we got to be more disciplined about it, you know. None of these are
like
anecdotes.
I would like to travel back to New Hampshire and be on the show. I'll do that soon.
No, we're not allowing you in the studio. There's a code, and we don't give it out to people that are mentally unstable unless they already have a show. Okay, Ed, I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
All right.
Well, that was certainly interesting, folks. I would have been better off talking to Paul. I love Ed, but, you know, well, sometimes, you know, people mirror yourself, huh? Till next week. Hopefully we'll just be doing cultural events now. I guess we're not going to be on for the next 2 weeks, but I will create something and run it. But I got to do it within a few days. We don't want to bore you. Bye.
You've done real good, Mom.
Me, Hat? Where did I pass the whole test before he tells me I'm too old? Should have remembered my wig. When are you coming back?
Whenever it's time, Ma.
Don't seem right to leave a old lady alone. And what about my goddamn license? Oh, this just...
Why didn't you tell him you wear glasses?
None of this goddamn business what I wear. Just wear them to read anyway.
Was there anything else?
The time has come for us to say sayonara. My heart will always be yours for eternity.